play that funky music, an absolute fucking banger of a track to play bass to. This cover came about because I played in wedding and corporate bands for a few years, and I would just find myself belting out this song of a night and just being so comfortable locking in with the drummer. I wanted to compile all of these ideas, which fucking took forever, into one gigantic take. And it was really quite challenging because there were so many fucking hundreds of ideas to choose from, and it was a matter of making them work well together with each other and kept in the groove, but without being too over the top or, you know, ridiculously wanky or flashy, or just basically laying down something for the sake of it as opposed to really sitting in the groove and giving what I think added to this song. I really like the ideas I've come up with. If you dissect them and break them down, they can be quite interesting and can be used, I guess, on a vast majority of styles or other songs. This is just naturally what has came out for me. So the playing style in this recording for me naturally is quite aggressive. So a lot of the tone comes from me digging in. You know, I've got a tendency to probably play a little bit too hard sometimes, especially live. But when we're talking about tone for this track, before any instruments, any DIs, mics, gear, you name it, we'll go into the whole lot of it. When we're talking about the sound and feel and tone of this track, it starts with really aggressive playing. I'm not sure the same attack or feel would come across if you weren't really fucking meaning it and digging in the way that, yeah, I hope I've pulled off okay for this song anyway. What I feel quite strongly about and what I really want to deliver in my videos, in this video particularly, is not only how recording gear works together, but specifically why I use it, why I choose it in order to achieve the tone or tones that I've been able to pull with kadeturner.com and especially this cover in general. It's really critical to understand your gear. It's really critical to understand them individually and then together. And it also really helps, and I hope I can bring some insight or clarity to anyone here. It really helps if you have a desired tone that you're reaching for before the recording. And I was really excited to be innovative with this tone because I think it's quite original. And the way that we achieved it is really fucking cool because I've used a piece of audio gear that I hadn't used before, which has a really distinct, throaty, meaty sound, and I'll get to all that in a second. Playing a funk song, I think should be played on a funk purpose-built bass. So I've chosen my 2001 Music Man Sterling for this track. It's actually the second bass I've ever owned, and I've got the original receipt for this. It was purchased in August in 2001 in Melbourne, which was 2 hours drive from where I grew up in a small country town called Traralgon in Australia. Now, I love this bass so much. I've done so many gigs and so much work with it that I actually had it completely restored. I got a new nut made. I've had every screw pulled off this thing and polished. Richard, my luthier, is from Sydney, Australia, and he is one of the best I know, one of the most thorough, genuine luthiers. And we went over everything as best as we possibly could on this thing. I mean, it's got a whole new pickup. So that's been replaced. It's had a new pick guard. And the fretwork's been done. The electronics were looked at and made sure that they were all Mickey Mouse for the new pickup. And it's just basically had a spruce up and a clean otherwise. For a 2001 model bass that's done the amount of work that this thing has done, it is in really, really good condition. And it's really worked well for the tone of this track because of the maple neck. You know, it's really good for slapping. It's really good for mids to pull through. And it's just got that distinct Music Man tone. And I think doing fingerstyle and playing slap for this cover has worked really, really well. And this bass was just an animal to record with for it. So yeah, that's my 2001 Music Man Sterling. So the tone of this track, I really wanted to be innovative. I wanted something deep and throaty and aggressive and meaningful. And that's easy in theory to talk about, you know. It's a lot harder to put into practice. And when you actually start laying down the track, if your bass isn't set up right or your gear isn't set up right, or you don't understand how to use that gear together, you can just murder the recording. So I'm gonna take you through exactly how I recorded this, how I got this tone and why. And yeah, we'll start with the first DI that I've run into. Many of you know my first piece of go-to recording equipment, you know, nearly on everything that I've used is this Avalon U5. I mean, I use it because it's solid state. It's just a tank. There's kilos of weight in it. It's American made. It has class A electronics, discrete electronics. It's a pure, crystal clear sound of your bass that I would argue is enhanced because of the componentry in it. You can get a direct sound of the bass if that's what you're after, or you can play with the tone and get a bit of EQ for it too. So for me, the reason I use this is because it's true, it's clean, it's clear, it's bulletproof. The guys are fucking awesome to deal with. I have talked with these guys in the States extensively, specifically about this product. And, you know, I won't harp on about the technical jargon, but if you want a good, true, clean, clear, usable piece of gear, I would highly recommend going straight into this as your first port of call for recording. Absolute fucking demon. So this is the second piece of gear that I've used for this recording. Now, the reason I've used this is because it has a slight tube emulation. If you want to really drive it hard, you can. I never would. I wouldn't have the settings on over a third, you know, including blend and presence and drive. I've always felt that anything more than that with this pedal was a bit too much. But the reason I've had it second in the chain is because I've had it direct out of the Avalon. And it's just the two of them together have been enough to fatten up the sound to give me something to reamp with that's workable. And this naturally has a bit of a, it could be subtle or it could be an illusion, but it feels to me a bit of a natural tubey sound, almost in compression. And that way you're able to, I guess, remove anything harsh or MIDI that you might pick up, say, from the Avalon or from the base itself, and blended the Avalon and this together, I found really, really worked good for a reampable, workable tone. That's the second piece of gear in the chain of this cover, and why I've used it. This was a significant part in the sound, a massive part in the sound of this cover. This is Stephen Slate virtual microphone system, digital mic, VMS, whatever you want to call it. The sounds from this thing are incredible. Now, why I've chosen this is because I actually re-amped the sound of my Avalon and Sans amp through my Mark Bass cab and amp. I used Mark Bass for years and I wanted the actual sound of that cab, but I wanted it captured with some flavor and some color, and how we were able to get that through this piece of gear here and my Mark Bass amp was just incredible. So to signal this out on its own, I haven't heard anything very similar to this because it's not generic, it's quite innovative. And the tone that was pulled through this and the Mark Bass cabin amp was just fucking incredible. So in the chain, we have the Avalon U5, we have the Sans amp bass driver DI, then we have that reamped through my Mark Bass cabin amp, captured with this Stephen Slate virtual microphone system. Absolutely fucking awesome, and in my view, quite innovative. I've not heard too many funk songs done this way. It's just started raining here, so if that comes through the microphone or not, I'm not sure, but that's what you get for living out where I do. So it wasn't enough to just capture the audio through the Avalon, the Sans amp, and the reamp of the Mark Bass. So we've done a last reamp through this Mesa Boogie Subway Bass DI. And the reason I've chosen this to do that is because the Mesa Boogie Subway series amps have a certain solid state zing that my carbine, you know, half tube, half solid state amp just doesn't have. I won't necessarily say that this is better, but I just really like this tone. I actually do blend this in with my Mesa Boogie carbine rig live or in the studio sometimes, but adding this flavor on top was the final piece to that throaty, meaty, clear top end sound, and that's how I was able to achieve the tone for this track. Four pieces of gear that are extremely unlikely to be used together. And I think it's even more unlikely, and I'd like to think innovative, to use a Mesa Boogie pedal for a funk song. So that's the audio chain and signal for this track. And yeah, I really hope you guys fucking dig it. I think it's important to put some thought into what strings you want before you start the recording in order to be able to shape the tone that you're after. They're 45 to 105, very standard gauge, absolute standard tuning. It's very easy to set intonation. There's not really much tweaking of the neck because it's common for me to stay in standard tuning. And they don't have too much of that over the top bright zing, but they do give a lot of nice natural overtones. They are a medium to medium bright style of string. And I think they work really well on this bass, and I think they worked really well for this song. So Ernie Ball Slinkies, 45 to 105 killer, killer sounding strings on this bass for this track. So it's really quite enjoyable for me to do these breakdown and tone videos. I would argue as enjoyable as the playing. Tone sculpting is a mega, mega passion of mine. And I hope I've been clear and articulated myself properly, and that you're able to take from this video exactly how this tone was achieved. I mean, there is always minor post mixing production, but I tend to lean towards getting the sound as close as I possibly can on the way in for the recording, and that way it's all done physically and I was able to monitor it physically and obtain it through DIs and pedals and amps and microphones. Now this song is recorded in 48K, and you know, I upload WAV files to my YouTube, so they are of a high audio quality standard, the best that I'm able to physically give YouTube. I really hope you guys enjoy it and that you can take something from this video, and I've had a fucking ball doing it, so cheers again. What, do you reckon that's enough?
Dude, it's fucking heaps.
Yeah.